Welcome back to Return of the King, Part 4. Let's get going. So, I'll do a short recap of where we've been thus far in the Return of the King series, which is essentially what the battle is all about. So, the plan of God concerning man, God made this physical creation, and it was his intention for man to rule it, for man to have dominion over it. But man went his own way, and there were these three great divine human rebellions, which we saw. So, we're in a position that man needs a savior. Because God essentially put man in charge of this creation. Man made mistakes. Man gave it away. A man has to take it back. So man needs a savior to save him from this pickle that he's put himself into. That savior must be a man. And Jesus is a savior. Jesus is the Savior. He is Yahweh, yet he is also man, born of a woman. So with the first coming, he nullified death, which was the result of the first rebellion. He issued eviction notices, which was the result of the second rebellion. Though for those Elohim who are not supposed to be here to set up residence here. And with the second coming, a man shall reclaim the earth. A man shall take it back after it was foolishly stolen away from men because of the rebellion and the short-sightedness of men. And that shall also evict all the rebellious angels, all the rebellious Elohim, the rebellious gods that are here, that have set up residence here for thousands of years. So, let's get into the second coming. So the first question we need to ask is, what exactly is the second coming of Jesus? What is it? We know about the first coming. We know about when Jesus came the first time. But what exactly is the second coming of Jesus? Right. So what is exactly the second coming of Jesus? Well, technically, there are two times that Jesus is prophesied to return after the resurrection and the ascension. Right. So he's prophesied to return in some major way for two events. So we shall, let's look at these two events. The first event is the rapture, where it's prophesied that he comes in clouds, or he comes with the clouds. And the second event is what is actually the second coming, where he comes and sets his feet on earth. Okay, so let's go forward. So let's deal with the rapture first of all. We can't do the second coming of Jesus and not do the rapture. So let's take a look at the rapture. So reading from 1 Thessalonians 4:15, "For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep or those who have died." All right, "we shall not go before them." What had happened was in Thessalonica, they were expecting Jesus to come within their to return in their lifetime, and he hadn't, and people started to die. So there were some fears and some issues, and this was Paul setting things straight. All right, so teaching the people of Thessalonica and setting things straight. "So we who are alive will not precede, will not go to the Lord before those who have died. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command," or some translation says with a shout, "with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord." So at some point, Jesus will come. There will be a shout, there will be a noise, there will be a trumpet, and we will meet the Lord with those who have died believing in Christ. We will all meet the Lord in the air. That's the rapture. The rapture is the Greek word hapazo. It means to be violently snatched away. All right, let's continue. And reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 51. "Behold, I tell you a mystery." Now a mystery is something, or in the culture, a mystery is something that was previously unknown and has now been revealed. All right? So Paul is telling a mystery. He's giving people revelation. "So behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep," meaning we shall not all die. So Paul is teaching the people of Corinth. "So we shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye." And many years ago, a fantastic teacher by the name of Chuck Missler actually calculated how fast is a twinkling of an eye. It's extremely fast. A fraction of a second. So in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable. This means that the dead will resurrect, but they will resurrect in a manner that is eternal. It's imperishable. It does not decay. It does not age. It's not subject to entropy. "And the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed." We shall be changed. "For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality." You see, for years, we have been taught that the end game of Christianity is to go to heaven and to be a spirit in heaven. That's the end game of the Greco-Roman religion. The end game of Christianity and of Judaism before Judaism was changed, right? And Judaism in the Old Testament was resurrection. The scripture says, "A body thou hast prepared for me." That's the end game. The end game is for us to put off these temporary bodies that we are in and put on a permanent one, one that is not subject to disease, to illness, to decay. Okay? So for this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. So that's what the rapture is about. We are taken away, we are caught with the Lord in the air, right? We meet the Lord in the air and we are changed. These bodies will be changed and we'll be given bodies like the one Jesus has. The one where he could just appear and disappear at will. But let's continue. One, in the Old Testament, a lot of the time we see certain things done, and those things are meant to teach us about how God deals with things, or to teach us certain concepts. And one concept, one practice that teaches us the rapture is the practice of ancient Jewish weddings. All right, the entire ancient Jewish wedding procedure, for lack of a better term. All right, so let's take a look at that and look at how that foreshadows the rapture. So, ancient Jewish wedding practices. At some point, the bride and the groom are betrothed. They are not married, but they are not free to get married to anyone else. At this point, the groom would have paid the bride the price. All right? It's not ASEA like, you, hey, let's go, let's hook up. No, the groom would have paid for the bride. The bride would have cost the groom something, right? So they are betrothed. They then separate, and usually, unless, I mean, if they're in the same town or whatever, they may take, get glimpses of each other, but generally, they do not see each other during this period where they are separated, waiting to get married. Traditionally, this period used to be a year, but there was no strict time frame on it. All right? The bride prepares herself. She learns how to do stuff in the house, but what's most important, she makes her wedding garment. She prepares her wedding garment. If you remember in the last video, I stated that your garments are essentially a foreshadowing or a type or typology for righteousness. Not righteousness that you earn, but righteousness that you put on. Okay? The groom goes and builds a room or a self-contained suite in his father's house. When Jesus was about to die, he said, "In my father's house, there are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you." Unfortunately, that's a slight mistranslation. The word translated mansions is actually suites. In my father's house, there are many suites, there are many rooms. So the groom goes and builds an addition in his father's house. He builds a suite, he builds a room for himself and his new bride when get married. When the father, not the groom, when the father judges that everything is ready, he tells the groom to go and get the bride. So he says, "Okay, We're ready for the ceremony. Go get the bride. The wedding ceremony, the marriage happens now. The groom and his friends then go to the bride's house. This could be done any time of the day or night, but traditionally, it was done in the wee hours of the morning when people are asleep. They just go, they don't announce that they're coming, they don't make any plans. They go and they go to the bride's house. When they are close to the house, the groom will shout and someone will blow a trumpet. The bride is supposed to have been ready. She's supposed to be ready to move at any time, day or night. So when they shout, the bride is just supposed to get up. All right? After the commotion is made, after the trumpet is blown and the shout is made, the groom's friends rush into the house, bodily pick up the bride and carries her, without her feet touching the ground, carries her back to the house of the groom's father, back to her future father-in-law's house. This bodily pick up and snatch away is basically hapazo. So the ancient Jewish wedding practices were a type, a foreshadowing of a coming event called the rapture. Let's continue and look at something else. So, as I said, the scripture is full of things, actual things that human did, practices, and even sometimes things that God told men to do. There was a prophet that God told him to walk around naked. There was another prophet God told him to go and marry a prostitute. So God would have people do various things to foreshadow future incidents. There was an issue where when Israel was in the wilderness, before they entered Canaan, they started to get attacked by snakes. God told them to make a snake out of bronze and set it on a pole. And when snakes attack, you look at that snake and you'll be saved. It ended up going badly because people started to worship that snake. And years after, they had to destroy it. But God only played off that snake many hundreds of years later. Actually, a couple thousand years later, when Jesus was on the cross. So we look at Jesus, we put our faith in Jesus, and we are saved. But let's look at a passage here. And the passage I want to look at is Genesis 22 and 24. The incident of the Akedah. I'm not going to read it, right? All right, so we're looking at the Akedah and how the Akedah is a foreshadowing of the rapture. So Abraham, who was the father, dwelt in Beersheba. Beersheba means the well of the sevenfold oath. There are many who believe that there's the whole creation is a 7,000 year oath. So Abraham dwelt there in the well of the seven. Next, we see Abraham. All right, this is not the Akedah. My bad, it's not the Akedah, it's the whole wedding of Isaac and Rebecca. But yeah, the Akedah is the incident on where Abraham gave up his son. So next we see Abraham sending his unnamed servant to get a wife for his son Isaac. The servant in the entire passage, in this entire passage, the servant's name is not stated anywhere between Genesis 22 and 24. He's just an unnamed servant who completely does the will of Abraham. Completely unnamed. However, we do see the servant's name, just not in this passage. In Genesis 15, we see that the servant's name is Eleazar of Damascus. Now, Eleazar means God's help, which is different from Eleazar, meaning God will help, right? Eleazar is from where, what's translated in the New Testament as Lazarus, but Eleazar means God's help. Now let's take a slight detour or a slight off ramp and look at a passage here. And the passage is John 14 and verse 16. And Jesus speaking says, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him." He's unknown to the world. He's unknown to the world. "But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you." So Eleazar is meant in this passage. Abraham, of course, is meant to be the father. Isaac is the son. And Eleazar, in this passage, is meant to be a type of the Holy Spirit. Let's continue. So, we see Abraham, who dwells in the well of the seven. We see he sends his unnamed servant to get a wife for his unique, his one-of-a-kind son, Isaac. We see the name of the servant is God's help. We see that the servant gives gifts to the bride. The bride, in addition to the bride price paid to the bride's family or to who owns the bride, because in those days, the women were property. So, in addition to that, the servant gives gifts to the bride, who is Rebecca. The servant brings the bride to Isaac at Beer Lahai Roy. Beer Lahai Roy means the well of the living one who sees me. So Isaac is living at the well of the one who is alive. The one who was dead and who is now alive. The well of the living one who sees me. And then the wedding ceremony happens. This is another type to teach us about the rapture. Okay? Let's continue. So, there are three types of rapture believers. Right? Now, I assume that everyone listening to this video would have heard about the tribulation to come. The tribulation is mentioned throughout the Bible in Daniel, but quite a bit, most people know it from listening to the book of Revelation. So the tribulation is this 7-year period split into two halves, and the second half is called the Great Tribulation period. It's called the Great Tribulation, sorry. So there are three types of rapture of the people who believe that there will be a rapture. There are three types. There are those who believe that the rapture will be before the tribulation. Those are pre-trib believers. Then there are those who believe that the rapture will take place at the midpoint, 3.5 years into the tribulation, before the Great Tribulation starts. So they are mid-trib rapture believers. And finally, there are those who believe that the rapture occurs after the tribulation. And of course, they are post-trib rapture believers. Personally, I am a pre-trib believer. That's what I choose and that's what I believe in. And I'll show you why. So, I like to read from this passage. Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered together with him, we ask you, brothers, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by a spirit or a spoken word or a letter seeming to be from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. Let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come, meaning the day of the Lord, unless the rebellion comes first. Some translations will say unless the falling away comes first, and the man of lawlessness is revealed, or the man of perdition is revealed or is unveiled, the son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself against every so-called god or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And you know what is restraining him now, so that he may be revealed in his time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is out of the way. So, this man of lawlessness is obviously what we Christians sometimes like to refer to as the Antichrist. Although that's not really in Revelation anyway. Right? So the Antichrist, the son of perdition. He has so many names. So, from this passage, we see that he will be revealed only when he who restrains, or the restrainer, is out of the way or is no longer here. But who is the restrainer? So, who is the restrainer? Let's read from Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, or the earth was tohu and bohu. It was complete chaos. It had no structure. It was chaos. And darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God, and the Spirit of the Lord, and the Ruach Yahweh was hovering over the face of the waters. What was the Spirit of God doing here? He was keeping things in check. He was maintaining order. He was restraining chaos. Look at another passage. That was Genesis 1. But let's look at another passage. And reading from John 14 and verse 15. Jesus speaking. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. To be with you forever. He will never leave you nor forsake you. God will give you a helper who will never leave you, even the Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. So the Holy Spirit will not leave you, will not forsake you, and he dwells in you. Let's keep going. Let's look at a passage from probably the single greatest prophetic book in the Bible, the book that I like to say that the whole linchpin of end times prophecy hinges on. So this is Daniel chapter 9 and verse 26. And a few months ago, I did a video on Daniel's 70-week prophecy. All right, you should probably take a look at it. All right. So Daniel 9:26, and after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. The word cut off there means killed, murdered. So after 62 weeks, the Messiah shall be murdered, shall be killed, but not for anything he did, or not to pay any price of his, or to, you know, in response to anything he did, not for himself. And the people of the prince who is to come, the people of the ruler who is to come, this ruler who is to come, this prince who is to come, is the prince who is to come at the end of time to resist all things of God. So it's the people of the Antichrist. So the people of the prince who shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. Until the end of the war, desolations are determined. Then he, who is he? He, the people of the prince who shall come. They were talking about the people of the prince who shall come. Shall destroy everything. Alright? Shall destroy everything. Then later on, after he made a mess of it, after they destroyed everything, he there is the prince who is supposed to come. Then the prince, he, the ruler, shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. Now, if you read the 70-week prophecy of Daniel, for 69 of those weeks cover up until Jesus is crucified. But it's 70 weeks. The last week is the tribulation. So at the beginning of that week, just before the tribulation, the prince, the Antichrist, shall confirm a covenant with many at the beginning for 1 week. But in the middle of the week, at the halfway point, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. He's going to paint himself as a man of peace, a man who is all for Israel and all about order and peace. And then halfway through, he's going to show who he truly is. He shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. He shall exalt himself over all things. Right? However, what's important in this passage is we just looked at some passages. The first one stated that the Antichrist will not be revealed while the restrainer is here, while the restrainer is on earth. He cannot be revealed because the restrainer is holding things in order. He's holding things from completely falling apart. When the restrainer is removed, the Antichrist is revealed. Okay? We see in this passage that the Antichrist confirms a covenant for 1 week at the beginning. All right? at the beginning of the tribulation. But before he confirms that covenant, he has to be revealed. And what stops him from being revealed is the restrainer. Yet we see the restrainer is removed. And also, in the middle of these passages, we saw Jesus saying that the Holy Spirit is with you forever. He dwells within you, and he will not be taken away from you. He will never leave you or forsake you. So if they pull away the Holy Spirit, those who have the Holy Spirit are pulled away as well. That is why I am a pre-tribulation rapture believer based on these passages. Okay? I'm not going to see the tribulation. I'm going to be with Christ on vacation. Let's continue. So, the next obvious question is, what triggers the rapture? Something has to trigger it. And everything we need to know is in the Bible. So let's look at what the Bible says triggers the rapture. And reading from Romans 11, verse 25. Lest you be wise in your own sight, I do not want you to be unaware of this mystery, brothers. A partial hardening has come upon Israel. All right? A hardening of the heart, partially, a hardening of heart has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. The rapture that removes a mostly Gentile church is not meant by God to be a punishment. It's meant by God to spur people unto righteousness. Those people who refuse to believe when Jesse, a bunch of people, are gone, it should basically spur people to realize this thing is real. God is real. This isn't a lie. And one of those people that are supposed to spur into that is Israel. This isn't a lie. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the Messiah. And what triggers this rapture is when something called the fullness of the Gentiles has been reached. What's the fullness of the Gentiles? The fullness of the Gentiles is a number. I don't know the number. No one knows a number except God. What is important is it's a number. So those of you who like spiritual warfare, yet the most effective spiritual warfare isn't Satan abide and loose you and etc. That's not the most effective spiritual warfare. The most effective spiritual warfare is bringing to the table the person who will destroy witness. That person is Jesus. He will destroy wickedness. And one step in bringing him here is letting whatever number of people that need to be saved, try to get it to come to pass. And how do you do that? You tell people about what you believe. You tell people about the Bible. It's their choice if they choose to believe or not, but you do what you can to spread the information. You plant a seed, then it's up to God and the people who hear it. That's your job. And that's the most effective spiritual warfare it has, to let the gospel spread. The gospel is like a virus. It goes anywhere and it will infect some. And that's the most effective spiritual warfare. That's what triggers the rapture. At some point, a number is going to be reached. Number of people who believe and who are loyal is going to be reached. And the Father will say, go get them. So that's the rapture. Let's continue. So, getting back to the second coming of Jesus to earth. Right, let's read a passage here. The purpose of the second coming. And reading from John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, or his one of a kind son, that whoever believes in him, his monogenic son, right? His one of a kind, his unique son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. This passage does not say, for God so loved the Jews that he gave his only son. It didn't say, for God so loved Christians that he gave his only son. It says, for God so loved the world, so that whoever, Jesus not returning here, yet is mercy. God wants everybody to be saved. And everybody believes, do your part. But let's continue about why Jesus is coming back. This is why Jesus is coming back. Let's continue. And reading from Matthew 24:21. For then there will be great tribulation, such as has not been from the beginning of the world until now, no, and never will be. And if those days had not been cut short, no human being would be saved. But for the sake of the elect, those days will be cut short. A time is coming. Today, as I'm recording this, is the 31st of December 31st of December 2023. And at any point in my life, at more now than any point in my life, it's like if humanity could end itself at any time. We have North Korea threatening to nuke South Korea and United States. We have China threatening to invade Taiwan, which is going to be chaos, right? Because invading Taiwan, that's going to trigger a massive war that could lead to a nuclear exchange. We have Russia threatening everybody to nuke them. They threaten to wipe out Israel. They threaten to wipe out the United States. Well, they threaten that 3-4 times a week. They threaten to wipe out Finland, to wipe out Sweden. So at any time, men these days apparently as if they hate peace. And the study of the Bible, I've been studying the Bible for 30 years. So because I've been studying the Bible for 30 years, I've been studying history for 30 years. And the history of man is the history of warfare. And there has yet been a single weapon in the thousands of years of man being here. There has yet been a single weapon that man has made that has not been used extensively. Let me hold that there for a second. No weapon, no matter how terrible, has not been used. Men are capable of remarkable things, of insanely remarkable things. Yet we seem hell-bent on two things. One, on subjugating and oppressing each other, right? There shouldn't be a single starving person or a single person with lack on this planet. But people are just insistent on being unjust, on being, I don't know. Men are just hell-bent on destroying men. And at some point, things are going to go awry. And they're going to go awry so bad that if Jesus wouldn't return to stop men, men will wipe themselves out. Men will wipe themselves out, and that is contrary to God's plan. And nothing, not even the best and worst intention of men, will cause God's plan not to be fulfilled. Men will rule this earth and do whatever God had intentioned for us to do. We cannot stop it. God would not allow us to stop it. So before we end ourselves, and I should say this, there are many who've watched a whole bunch of horror films and believe that the second coming is the end of the world. The second coming is not the end of the world. It's the end of the age. We'll get to that later, but let's continue. So when should we look out for the second coming of Jesus? When should we expect it? Somewhere around AD 32, Jesus said, I'm coming back. AD 32 is just 9 years. Well, it's going to be 2024 in a couple hours. So it's 8 to 9 years. Let's say 8 years. By the time I put this video out, it's going to be 2024. So it's just 8 years shy of 2,000 years since Jesus said that he is coming back. So when shall we look out? When should we look out for it? Let's take a look, see. So reading from Matthew chapter 24 and verse 26. But concerning that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. So in Matthew 24 verse 36, Jesus is saying, don't look for me to tell you a date and a time. And nobody knows that, and that won't be revealed to anyone. However, the Bible says that once you believe, you're God's friend, and God does not, withhold things from his friends. So we may not know the date and the time that Jesus is returning, but we do know something. Let's look at a passage here. Slightly before verse 36, going up, instead of going down, let's go up to verse 32. And this is Jesus speaking. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see all these things, you know that he, who is he? Jesus. Now Jesus is saying that you know that he is near. What Jesus is saying, when you see all these things, you know that the second coming is near. It's at the very gate. You're in the last stretch. You're in the last days. So what is the lesson? What this lesson of the fig tree thing has to do with the second coming? Isn't that just a nice parable? The Bible explains Bible. In 2021, I did a whole commentary on the book of Revelation. And everything in the book of Revelation that seems to be just crazy and out there is explained somewhere else in the Bible. Because the Bible has 40 different writers, but there is one person who inspired it, and that's him. And it's amazing. 40 different writers. Many of whom, particularly in the Old Testament, didn't know each other, lived across hundreds of years, and yet they used the same figures of speech, they used the same types and typologies. So it's 40 different books, but it's one book. So let's take a look at some things here. So, reading from Hosea. Hosea is one of the minor prophets. When I say minor prophet, it doesn't mean he's not that important. It means that his books, or the books of these guys, are small. So they're the major prophets like Ezekiel and Isaiah. Isaiah had a massive, massive book. But then there are some minor prophets. Some of their books are a paragraph. Right? So minor doesn't mean that they aren't important, because in fact, the minor prophets, if you want to know all about eschatology, get into the minor prophets. Eschatology is the study of the time of the end. Anyway, reading from Hosea chapter 9 and verse 10. Like grapes in the wilderness, I found Israel. Like the first fruit on the fig tree in its first season, I saw your fathers. But they came to Baal Peor and consecrated themselves to the thing of shame and became detestable like the thing they loved. Throughout the Bible, you see a couple motifs. One motif is to mention Israel when it refers to a nation. But a lot of the time, when Israel is called a fig tree, it's because they're also their nation, but they are in an apostate state. So they are a nation, a tree, but they're an apostate nation. They're a nation who do not believe in their God. Right? We see that over and over. When the nation is righteous, they are usually referred to as an olive tree. But when they're apostate, when they're unbelieving, they're referred to as a fig tree. So let's take a look at something again. Let's go back. Back to Matthew 32. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that the summer is near. Learn the lesson of the fig tree. It's planted. As soon as it starts to shoot out branches and start to pop off leaves, meaning as soon as the fig tree sprouts up, as soon as there's a planted fig tree, as soon as the fig tree shoots up out of the earth, know that the time is near. As soon as it pops up, we ain't even reach fruit yet. It putting out just leaves, right? It now hatch from a seedling and it shoot out of the earth, and it has one or two leaves and it's one or two branches, or just probably a little branch. In fact, it said it's branch, not branches. Its branch just shoot out of the earth, out of the ground. Sorry, I'm not really into farming that much. So you plant the seed and the branch has basically grown out of the ground and is now shooting out teeny leaves. When you see that, know that the summer is near. We are in the last days, because the fig tree shot out of the ground May 15th, 1948. Israel became a nation again on May the 15th, 1948. They don't necessarily believe in the Messiah, but they are a nation again. So you want to know when the second coming is? Look at the fig tree. Keep watching fig tree. The thing is, there is a fig tree now. There hasn't been a fig tree since about AD 130, when Israel was largely expelled from the land by the Romans and kept out of it and kept in a state for years by various people, by the Crusaders, by the Turks, etc. But 1948, the fig tree came out of the ground. Israel is a nation again. So since 1948, we are in the last days. Let's look at the ages. So, the ages. Probably, I think it's one day or just around the time that Israel was founded as a nation, a discovery was made at a place called Qumran, close to the Dead Sea. A bunch of scrolls belonging to a group of people called the Essenes. Now, by the time of Jesus, prior Judaism was essentially one group, but by the time of, well, long before Jesus, right? A little after the Seleucid period, or around the Seleucid period, Judaism split up into three factions. We see two of them mentioned in the New Testament. We see the Pharisees and we see the Sadducees, but there was a third group who wanted to stay so close to what was God's plan, because the Sadducees or the Zadokites, the Zadokim, only believed in the five books of Moses, and they didn't believe in things like resurrection. So they lived anyhow because they didn't believe in an afterlife, or they didn't believe in resurrection. So this was the best you can get, so let's live your best life now. The Pharisees were a little more godly. They believed in pretty much most of the Bible, but they rejected things, and then they started talking about things that the Essenes stated didn't exist. They started to go a bit off track as far as the Essenes were concerned. And the Essenes wanted to stay as accurate as possible. So they had what they claim to be the original Hebrew calendar. And why is a calendar important? Because according to the Hebrews in the first and second temple periods, their calendar is all about prophecy. Their calendar and prophecy, they're tied to time. So the original Essene calendar was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. I'm not going to get into it because that's long. However, there is one guy who is largely translating as much of the Dead Sea Scrolls that we can find or that exists out there. He's translating it into English. It's a guy named Ken Johnson. He has some YouTube videos and he has a website, which is BibleFacts.org. And it's extremely interesting. If you get into the Dead Sea Scrolls, you'll realize the Essenes sound extremely Christian. And the writings of the Essenes that they claim belong to the patriarchs, etc., sounds extremely Christian. And it will open your eyes to some things you see in the New Testament. In fact, if you read the Dead Sea Scrolls, a lot of Jews will become Messianic Jews. And that whole Islam Muslim story, a lot of that will just go away, will just change drastically. Because the Dead Sea Scrolls makes a lot of the writing of these scenes sound extremely Christian. And that is probably one reason why the Essenes essentially went away early in the Christian period, because they largely became Christians. Excuse me, but let's continue. So we're looking at the ages, so we're looking at time. In England, well, in our modern Gregorian calendar, time is broken down into days, weeks, months, years, centuries, which, well, decades, I missed out decades, which is 10 years, centuries, which is 10 decades or 100 years, and millennia, which is 1,000 years or 10 centuries. The Jews had days, weeks, months, but then, they also had years, but then they diverged a bit from how we do things. So the Hebrews, they had years. Then they had something called Shemitah. A Shemitah is 7 years, a 7 year period. Then they had Jubilees. A Jubilee is seven Shemitahs, so 7 by 7 is 49, plus an additional year called the Shemitah year. So a Jubilee is 50 years. And a Jubilee was very important. Every Jubilee, every debt in the land, right? And according to Mosaic law, every Jubilee, every debt in the land was wiped out. Every slave was set free. Everything was put right on the Jubilee. Okay? And then from Jubilees, we have owners. An owner is 10 Jubilees or 500 years. All right? So, let's continue. Sorry, I'm having throat problems, which is what happens every time I do that. So, continue. So, according to the same calendar and according to ancient Hebrew belief, from Adam to the end of the ages is 7,000 years of 14 onas. Okay? That 7,000 years is divided into four ages. The first age from Adam to the call of Abraham is approximately 2,000 years or four onas. The second age from Abraham to the destruction of the temple, and the destruction of the temple happened around AD 70. So from Abraham, between AD 70 and AD 75, so from Abraham to just around the destruction of the temple, it was a couple years after the age ended, was about 2,000 years of four unas. So thus far, so from Adam, the first age and the second age will count to eight unas. The third age is from around the time of the destruction of the temple to the king setting up the millennial kingdom. And that is prophesied to be another 2,000 years or four unas. And the final or fourth age, the final age is the millennial reign, where the king, where Jesus rules, the king of heaven and earth rules on the earth for 1,000 years or two unas. All right, so based on this, we are in the third age. All right, so when should we look out for the second coming? So, going back to the go-to passage, from the fig tree learn its lesson. As soon as its branch become tender, you know that summer is near. All right? The fig tree is Israel. Israel became a nation again after almost 2,000 years in 1948 on May 15th. All right? After almost 2,000 years, they became a nation again. All right, shortly into the Christian period, Israel was no longer a nation. They were expelled from the land violently, with extreme violence. All right, and after all of that, after almost 2,000 years in 1948, they became a nation again. We are therefore in the last days. This age started somewhere between AD 70 and AD 75, the third age started. The Essene calendar has the year 2023 as the year 5948. That means there are approximately 52 years to the end of the age. 51 by the time this video will be released to YouTube. 51 years to the end of the age. A lot of things are therefore going to happen in the next few years. Many things are going to happen in the next few years. Okay, so I'll be ending this video here. I'm breaking this video in two because it's a bit long. So this is a nice, neat, and logical place to end this video. Right at the end of when we should look out for the return of the Lord. So please look out for the next part where we will get into what triggers the second coming. So thank you. God bless.